Good morning, students. So today we are going to start third portion of our third unit. In this, we will be studying about a reactivity series. So on the basis of different properties of different metals with different compounds, we have made a reactivity series. So that we will be studying, and then how ionic compounds are formed, their formation will be studied, and what are their properties, that will also be studied. Okay. Now, first of all, how do metals react with solutions of other metal salts? We have done so many properties of reactions of metals with other substances. Now we are coming to the last type of activity. In this, we will be seeing the reaction of metal with other metal salts. Okay, just like we take copper metal and iron metal, we take their nail. We put copper metal wire in a solution of iron sulfate and iron nail in the solution of copper sulfate. Now we will see what happens. Okay. So this is the arrangement where you can see we have put an iron nail in the copper sulfate solution. Okay, and in this case we have taken copper wire and we have put it in the iron sulfate solution. Okay, so what results we will find? After some time we will see that iron nail gets a coating of copper. Okay, so what does it mean? It means iron has replaced copper from its solution. Okay, but if we will see copper wire in the iron sulfate solution, after some time, after 20 minutes, if we will take it out, then it will be as it is, means there will be no change. So in few cases there is change and in few cases there is no change. Why is it so? So this depends on the reactivity of the individual metal. Our iron metal is more reactive than copper, so it is able to replace copper from its solution, but copper is less reactive than iron, so it was not able to replace iron from its solution. Okay, now in general, what we can say, in general we can say a metal, when we put it in the salt solution of B metal, then product will be salt solution of A metal and metal B will come out. It will be only possible if A metal is a reactive metal, or it is more reactive as compared to B metal. Okay, so what we can say, more reactive metal when combines with solution, salt solution of less reactive metal, then less reactive metal comes out and more reactive metal forms its solution of salt. Okay, now we can understand it with the help of these examples. Now see, magnesium is more reactive than iron. So what it does, when we put magnesium in iron sulfate solution, there is formation of magnesium sulfate and iron comes out. Similarly, iron is more reactive than copper, so when we put iron in copper sulfate solution, there is formation of iron sulfate and copper comes out. But if we do the reverse, just like if I put copper in iron sulfate solution, then copper is less reactive, this is less reactive than iron, so there will be no reaction. Similarly, iron is less reactive than magnesium, so iron cannot take out magnesium from its solution, so there will be no reaction. Okay, so in general we have to remember this. Now on the basis of all the reactivities of different elements with other solutions, air, water, with all other things, acids, we have constructed a series. And we have arranged the known elements in the increasing, in the decreasing order of their reactivities. So this decreasing order of reactivity is known as reactivity series, or we say it is activity series. So potassium is in the beginning, so it is the most reactive element, and gold is at the end, it means it is the least reactive element. Okay, now how to remember this? There is one simple method. We can remember it like this: Kedar Nath Ka Mali Alu Jara Fee Pakata Hai. So with this line, what we remember? From Kedar we will remember K, from Nath we will remember Na, from Ka we will remember Ca, from Mali we will remember Mg, from Alu we will remember Al, from Jara we will remember Zn, from Fike we will remember Fe, from Pakata we will remember Pb, and from Hai we will remember hydrogen. Okay, after that all these four elements are least reactive elements. We have to remember one thing, that after hydrogen, immediately after hydrogen, there is copper immediately after hydrogen, and then mercury, and then silver and gold. Okay, so if we remember this line, Kedar Nath Ka Mali Alu Jara Fike Pakata Hai, then we can remember from potassium to hydrogen. And after that, what is to be remembered? Immediately after hydrogen, copper will come, and then mercury will come, and then silver and gold will come. Okay, so this way we need to remember this series. So where it is useful? See, that element which comes first, that element can replace the other elements from their salt solutions. So potassium can replace all these elements from their salt solutions. Okay, similarly aluminium can replace all these elements. Which elements? Aluminium can replace all these elements from their salt solutions, but it cannot replace these metals from their salt solutions, because aluminium is less reactive than potassium, sodium, calcium and magnesium, but it is more reactive than zinc, iron, lead, so it can replace these elements. Okay, so this way we have to remember it. Now before starting the ionic compound formation, we must know about the electronic configuration of elements. So see, since 20 we have to remember, so those elements which are active out of these 20, those we will be discussing. So here is the table. In this we have taken three types of elements: noble gases, metals and non-metals. So noble gases are three, till 20 we are talking. One is helium, then neon, then argon. Helium has atomic number 2, neon has 10 and argon has 18. So we know that K, L, M, N, we have to fill the electrons in these. So this way they will be filled. 2N square is the maximum number of electrons which we can put. Okay, so these will be the electronic configurations. Why these are required? Because we have to write Lewis symbols first. Lewis symbols, we know that we will be writing the symbol of elements. For example, I have to write Lewis symbol for aluminium. Aluminium has this electronic configuration. Okay, so it will be written like this: Al is the symbol of aluminium, and there are three valence electrons, so three dots will be there. This will become the Lewis symbol of aluminium. Okay, so when we are going to talk about formation of any compounds, then first of all we have to write the Lewis symbols of all the elements involved. Okay, so for that it is very important that we must know these electronic configurations. Now how do metals and non-metals react? Okay, now why they react? Their reaction is shown for two compounds we have shown here. In this slide we have shown for sodium chloride, in the next slide we have shown for magnesium chloride. So why this combination is there? Okay, so this is very important, just learn it. We can say that atoms tend to acquire noble gas configuration. Okay, that is, they need to complete their octet by loss or gain of electrons. And after doing so, means when they lose or gain electron, then the ions are formed, and those ions are attracted due to electrostatic forces of attraction, and because of this attraction they form ionic compounds. Okay, so now let us see the formation of sodium chloride. So there is one sodium and one is chlorine. So sodium, its electronic configuration is 281. When it loses an electron, then it forms Na positive and it comes in noble gas configuration. Similarly, Cl negative gains an electron and it becomes Cl negative, and again it comes in noble gas configuration. Now these two ions, this and this, has opposite charges, and so these two get attracted towards it once each other, and there is formation of bond. That bond is termed as ionic bond. Now see, this was in the Lewis form Na dot, and here Cl with 7 dots or cross. Dot and cross one and same thing. So one electron goes from here, Cl completes its octet, and there is negative charge on this. Na has lost one electron, so there is positive charge on this. Now these negative and positive ions, this negative and this positive and this negative ion, they will be attracted towards each other, and there will be formation of compound. Okay, similarly, if we talk about the formation of magnesium chloride, then what will happen? Magnesium is like this, electronic configuration is 282. When it loses two electrons, it comes in noble gas configuration. Okay, now one chlorine atom gains one electron and forms chloride ion. There are two chlorine atoms, so there will be gaining of these two electrons and two Cl negative ions will be formed. In Lewis representation, we will see like this. Mg has two electrons. It gives those two electrons to two Cl atoms, and there is formation of Mg2 positive, and two Cl negative ions are formed, which are attracted towards each other, and there is formation of magnesium chloride. Okay. Now, we will study about the properties of ionic compounds. So for that, we will perform a simple activity, and from that activity we will draw inferences, and then those will be the properties of ionic compounds. Now take samples of sodium chloride, potassium iodide, barium chloride, and any other salt. Now these are all ionic compounds, or we say they are salts. So we have taken different salts. Now take a small amount of a sample on a metal spatula and heat directly on the flame. Okay, now see, spatula, this is spatula which is used in chemistry lab. Okay, we have taken very less amount of a given salt and we have started heating it directly. Okay, now what we will observe? Okay, this is to be observed. So what we will observe? We will observe that different colored flames are formed for different salts. If it is sodium chloride, then we will see yellow color flame. Okay, so we will be seeing different color flames when we heat directly these ionic compounds. Okay, now we will take those samples and we will try to dissolve them in water, petrol, or kerosene oil. Now see, these compounds are of two categories: polar substances and non-polar substances. Polar substances are those in which there is separation of charges. Okay, and non-polar are those in which there is no separation of charges. So ionic compounds are polar in nature because of ion formation. So they are soluble in polar substances, they are not soluble in non-polar substances. So these ionic compounds will be soluble in water, because water is polar. They will not be soluble in kerosene oil or petrol. Okay. Now, one more thing. We will make a circuit. It has been shown in the next slide. So, we will make a circuit and we will insert the electrodes into the solution of salt. We will take salt, we will make its solution. Its solution will be prepared in water because it is soluble in water. Okay. And then we will maintain an electrical circuit and we will see whether it conducts electricity or no. Okay. So, what will be the result? These salts will be good conductor of electricity. Okay. Now, whatever we have discussed here, that again we are going to discuss. Very first thing, physical nature. Physical nature means how these compounds look like. So, any compounds, they are solid. Okay. And there is strong force of attraction between the positive and negative ions. Okay. Now, these compounds are generally brittle and break into pieces when pressure is applied. Okay. So, because of ions and because of crystal structure, they are brittle in nature. So, very first thing is that ionic compounds are solids. Now, second thing, since there is very much strong force of attraction, electrostatic forces are very strong forces. Okay. So, their melting and boiling point values are very high. Okay. Because of very strong intermolecular attractive forces. Now, third thing, solubility. Now, see, these compounds are soluble in water, but insoluble in kerosene or petrol, etc. Why? Because water is polar in nature and other these things, they are non-polar in nature. And ionic compounds are polar, so they are easily soluble in water. Now, let us come to conduction. Okay, now see, we have maintained an electrical circuit. We have installed a switch, a bulb, a battery, and these two conducting rods are there. Here we have taken the solution which is to be tested, whether it is conductor or it is insulator. Okay, so when we will perform this activity, then we will find that it is a good conductor of electricity. So ionic compounds are good conductor of electricity. Okay, now the conduction of electricity through a solution involves movement of charged particles. A solution of an ionic compound in water contains ions which move to the opposite electrodes. When electricity is passed through the solution, ionic compounds in the solid state do not conduct electricity because movement of ions in the solid is not possible. So, what two things we have to remember? First thing is, since there is formation of ions, when we take its aqueous solution, then there is formation of ions. And because of movement of ions, there is conduction of electricity. Now, if we take an ionic compound in solid state, then what will happen? If we take an ionic compound in solid state, then it will not conduct electricity. Why? Because there is no movement of ions. Movement of ions is possible only in aqueous state or in molten state. So, solid ionic compounds, they do not conduct electricity. Okay. So, this is all about the ionic compounds and their formation and their properties. Now, these are the home assignments which you have to complete. Okay. Thank you.